Hi, welcome back. The next presentation is from Tim, and he will speak about practical experiences with OpenNebula and software as a service.
Okay, hello, good morning, everybody. First of all, thank you for letting me speak here and for inviting me. So always a pleasure to share, and I always like coming to these conferences. Also, there'll be room for questionings at the end, but if you have a question in the meantime, just raise your hand and we'll see if we can answer your question. Okay, so this is a bit the layout of the presentation. So I'll start with a small introduction so that you know where I'm coming from and where I'm where my world is. And then I'm going to describe to you how my world looked before there was OpenNebula. Then I'll talk to you and explain you how my world looks today. That includes OpenNebula, else I wouldn't be here, I guess. And then I hope I can say I will try to explain you what my world will look like in the future. So first a bit about myself. I'm an infrastructure architect at Deloitte Consulting in Belgium. I started playing with Linux and open source in high school, basically, like about 15 years ago. And I had the luck, the fortunate to be able to make my job out of my hobby. So I've been playing with Linux and open source since then, basically. And throughout my career, I basically specialized in everything that's related to IT infrastructure. So servers, operating systems, deployments, networking, storage, backups, and everything, all the bottom side. The applications, that's for other people. So I work for Deloitte Consulting. For those who don't know Deloitte, it's a big international company. It's called one of the big four in terms of its financial accounting and things like that. They do. In Belgium, we're about 2,500 people over the whole department. So it's already a pretty big firm also in Belgium. And I'm part of the consulting division. There are three or four other big divisions. We basically live next to each other. We don't see much of each other. And within consulting, I'm part of the information management team. So information management, basically, we work with everything that's related to data in some form or another. And I'm in a team called the IMS for Analytics team. IMS stands for Application Management Services. And this is a very simple drawing of the things we work in day in, day out. And just going to quickly explain it so you can follow a bit in the rest of the presentation. This is what I call a drawing of a simple BI stack. BI stands for Business Intelligence. What you have at the bottom is basically databases containing the customer's productive data, the things they work in day out, day out. Their ERP system, their CRM, HRM, whatever, Excel slice, Access databases, whatever they have, whatever they use, that's at the bottom. Now, problem is if you want to do reporting or work with that data, the structure of that data within those functional systems is not suited very well to do the reporting stuff that we want to do. So we move all that data into a data warehouse. And there's a collection of data marts, it's a fancy word for a database. But it's not just a simple move. We also do transformations. That is what we call here ETL, stands for extract, transform, and load. And there's a standard way of transforming, of working with data in data warehouses and for reporting. And the ETL tool basically just transform the customer's data into a format that suits the reporting data. That can be an intensive process, like we have ETL jobs that basically run throughout the night for processing the customer's data. But then in the end, it all ends up in our big data warehouse. Then there is a semantic sort of semantic layer, basically to name what's inside the data mart, inside the data warehouse. So the front-end applications know what they're using. And there are different kinds. So you have the standard reporting, You've seen it, just a page with some graphs and some numbers, just showing the growth or the loss of whatever that's going on in the company. You have dashboarding. That's basically a more interactive form of standard reports. You basically get to play with the data live. You can zoom in, you can zoom out, you can do filters, and then all the graphs change and things like that. And then you have forecasting, which basically is a form of analytics, statistics. You run on the data, and then you try to make guesses into the future, or you basically play with data live and see what impact that has on the numbers. Wow. I hope this is a bit clear for everybody. Okay. So, as I said, I work for the Application Management Service for Analytics Applications team. It's a long word. We just call it AMS. It's much simpler. So, we basically manage the application stack just so for customers. And fortunately for me, it's only the technical aspects of all that. So, we upgrade, bug, monitor. We fix issues for customers. We do maintenance. If whatever basically they have, they can open a request with us, and we'll see if we can help them or not. All the functional side is basically done by project teams from within our consulting division. So they're usually at a customer, and we work with them closely to basically make sure that if tickets come to us that are more of a functional nature, we move them to them, so they can have a look at that. We're a small team, we're just 5 people. Basically means that we're doing a lot of different things, get a lot of interruptions, and yeah, that's life, I guess. Now we do this at the customer itself. Basically we just take over the management of their BI stack that's running there locally. And then we'll get to the my world before OpenNebula. They can do it with us. We have what we call the Deloitte Analytics Platform, or just DAP for short in our language. And this was the first version of DAP when I came to work for Deloitte Consulting. It's like you can see, it's really, really simple. You have a big storage box at the bottom. That's a IBM something storage box that contains all the data warehouse data. On top, you see 2 smaller pizza box servers, which was the DMZ. So there's a reverse proxy and SSL termination stuff going on there. And they have a set of blades, and each blade basically was assigned 1 function. You see 2 DB2 servers who run the data warehouse. You have 2 web servers, and you have 3 Cognos application servers. That was it. Everything was done locally, physically on the box. There was no virtualization, no automation. Here and there a small script, but all the rest was basically some documentation. Luckily already in a wiki, so it was already okay, they already done that. So that was a good thing. But as you can imagine, this is not really something we want. Now, true to be said, this basically was built like 5 years ago in a small company, not inside Deloitte. It's a company that Deloitte bought, and the platform came with that purchase. They started from scratch. So this was a first, for first try, for a first setup, this was pretty okay for their doing. But then in the meantime, things change. You get new customers coming. There were some projects coming that resulted in new hardware coming in, or need of new hardware. And then, of course, you have, as you can guess, there are some issues with this kind of setup. It does not scale, or not really flexible. If you want to add another application server, you have to install an OS, install the applications, configure it, connect it to the rest of the setup. It's not efficient in the use of its resources. So like, for example, the web servers, those 2 blades, they were all the same size, the same spec. So the same amount of memory, the same amount of cores, the same amount of disk. But like, the web servers were doing nothing, or almost nothing. So like, okay, not really efficient. It was, of course, not flexible. It's like, okay, when you only have your blades and then you can't play with it. And It's like this production system, you just can't also not use it for the test stuff on. And like I said, there was no automation there. So things needed to change. Basically, me and a colleague of mine, he's the guy actually got me hired to try to fix all this. So we sat together and then we brainstormed like, okay, where we want to go? This is okay, but we can do better than this. So that basically starts to lead me to how my world looks today. First, let me dazzle you a bit, a couple of logos and names. Luckily, OpenNibla is in the center, so hurrah. So this is what I get by day to day these days. This is what I play with these days. So it's a lot more than those original, just five pieces of hardware and then that's it. If your specific thing is not on here, come talk to me, maybe we can add it. So we started brainstorming like, okay, where we want to go with our platform. And this is then a high level drawing of what we had in mind, what you envisioned like, there we want to go. And some requirements there on the left. So first of all, if you want to build something new, it had to be flexible. We want to we have a production environment, we also want to be able to test stuff. There will new customers coming and going. Customers won't demand more performance sometimes, or just their data grows, so we need more processing power. So it needs to be flexible. We need to be able to cope a customer's demand. We work our bread and our basically my paycheck depends on our customers. So we're a completely customer-driven environment. Like if there are no customers, we can get to play with whatever. But if there's a customer demand, we drop everything and we try to help them. So we need something flexible to be able to cope with those kind of interruptions. Security is of course very important. We're working with customer data, it's financial data mostly. So as you can imagine, yeah, there are a lot of reports on the web of data leaks and all that stuff. We don't want that to happen to us. So security is very important. Then automation, well yeah, we're a small team, four people, two really technical people. So we like to a good admin is a lazy sysadmin is what people always say. So we try to automate as much as possible, like that we can have more time doing fun stuff than the boring repetitive stuff. It has to be scalable, like I said, data increases, load increases, so we want to be able to grow or reduce the size of the setup of what the customer has needs to use on demand. It needs to be monitored. I guess that speaks for itself, but yeah, not something should not ever lose sight of. And remember to monitor everything. You start at the bottom and you work your way up. You start with basically is my server there, and you end with end-to-end testing of a report from the internet, so we actually know what is the customer experience, as we can say, like, okay, how fast is the customer actually getting their reports? And you want to do that over time, so you can have an idea for doing better or the latency increasing. Is it going quicker? We're doing our job correctly or not? And of course, redundant. This is a 24/7 platform. The customer wants to be able to use it whenever he wants, so we can't afford any downtime. And then you get a nice diagram of high level functional wise what we want to do. So in the middle, you again have the data warehouse, but we already envisioned two versions. The structured one is basically your standard SQL database, but you also have an unstructured data warehouse for the more big data things like Hadoop or just file shares or something that can't fit in a regular database. Below is then how the customer gets their data in from their data sources. We again have the ETL to get data in, but we also have a simpler version of that we call DLP or Data Load Protocol. It's basically just a setup that allows customers to give us CSV files or Excel files, and we just import them into our database. And that's basically the two ways we interface with the customers and the customers' data. Then on the front end, all the blue boxes are basically all the different kind of front end reporting analytic applications we can run. You have standard reporting, you have data mining, data visualization, dashboarding, analytics, planning, and there are a lot of more. I won't bother you with those. And to have a sort of common way to let people access this, we have there a secured internet access portal layer in front. So the front-end security will happen there. They'll also, we try to have a nice interface so that people can access the platform in a nice way. Then on the right, if needed, for some customers it needed, there's a network box there that allow customers to basically access parts of our platform directly from their network. Usually that's only needed for, like, say, migration scenarios where their database is located inside the customer's environment, and the export-import process is not working yet, so we connect directly to the database for the while being. But we prefer not to do that as just a standard solution. We prefer the export-import of files to have a nice separation between the two worlds. And on the left, the important part for us is the management layer. So everything needed to manage this platform should be there. OpenEBLA, for example, will be there, but cloud management, configuration management, monitoring, backups, and all things like that. Okay, so that's how was our vision. Okay, this is what we want to build now. And then we had, of course, a lot of tools to choose from. And this was basically the list of our final selection. So for the actual real core management, we selected the trio of Puppet, Foreman, and OpenEBLA. Why OpenEBLA? I come back on the next slide, but Puppet and Foreman, we basically chose those two because Foreman is a very nice interface to Puppet, but it can also do deployments on hardware, which is something we also needed. So it was a win-win situation. And we also have some Windows machines, we can't get around that, unfortunately. So that also works with Puppet because it can also do that for us. For storage, we chose GPFS as basically a common platform, common cluster file system for our environment. It's a bit strange one, I guess, in this list. Reason, we played a bit with Gluster, but it wasn't ready enough for us at that moment. It misses some features like real replication between nodes, or is not easy to do, or not really built into Gluster. I played a bit with GFS a while back. That was also okay. That was okay. That worked, but it was also like the best performing thing you can find. And there's a lot of new stuff coming, but yeah, this is a production environment. It needs to work right now for us. So there's like, okay, this is not, we can't really find something that is there for us ready right now. I already knew GPFS from previous work, previous projects I did. And I know it works, it's stable, it's already 15 years old, it's supported by IBM, and then you have the standard rule like you never get fired by buying IBM. So in this case, it actually worked a bit for me. But it has an extra, well, it actually solves two problems for us. Basically, the storage now is independent of what's above it. We can change the storage. GPFS will take care of that. So the storage is itself, the physical hardware is transparent. Now we can buy a big sandbox, or we can use local disks. Doesn't matter. GPFS hides that from us. It can do replication inside, built in. You don't need anything else. You just say, okay, I want two copies of that data, three copies of that data. GPFS will arrange all that for you transparently. And you can also export file systems inside clients. So basically our hosts running all the VMs are physically connected to the storage using plain SAS for the moment. So if GPFS finds a direct connection to its storage, it will use that. But you can also access GPFS over the network. So in certain clients, we also need a sort of shared data pool, a file system. We just export small pieces of our GPFS file system into those clients. And they all see the same file system, also shared clustered automatically. So we have basically it's a one solution for a lot of different problems we had fixed in one piece. So that's why we got it. And actually, it's commercial, you have to pay for it, but the pricing is not that bad for other compared to other IBM stuff you can find in the market. Then in the DMZ, we got HA proxy. Luckily, version 1.5 was just around the corner, which supports SSL termination and offloading. So that's basically ideal. Okay, it can do everything for us. It's a reverse proxy. It will do SSL for us to the front end. We can have some security in there. It's like, okay, perfect. It's really easy to set up in a clustered setup. Just hey, a proxy, keep alive, two nodes, and you're ready to go. Then for our data warehouse, so as you've seen, originally we used DB2 because it was the old setup, also something actually IBM set up for us for a large part. But yeah, that costs a lot of money, so we want to get rid of that. And basically after some testing and a small evaluation project, we ended up with Postgres as basically our data warehouse. Why? Well, again, it's an open source tool, there's no licensing, so we can scale the way we want, we can set it up the way we want. It's a really an enterprise-ready database. It's basically been running us for like more than 2 years, almost 2 years now we're running that in production. It has never given us any problems. You can actually go pretty deep on tuning and playing with it. It has, for the moment, master-slave replication, which is sufficient for what we are doing. Multi-master replication is coming around the corner. So that might be something we're going to use in the future. There are backup tools already there. There are tools to manage the replication. There's a whole ecosystem around it. And it's really been a very good choice for us to use Postgres as our data warehouse. For big data, we for the moment didn't make any choices yet because there's no customer for the moment requiring from us to be able to do big data. We've played a bit with plain Hadoop, but yeah, that's something when the customer demand will be there, we'll see, evaluate then and see what the best tool will be for us for that scenario. Security, open LDAP, well, that's a pretty simple choice. It was already there and it's also easy to set these days in a multi-master replication mode, so that just was really simple to set up. Very important, SE Linux. If I see people disabling it, I kill them on site, basically. No, but you should basically keep it running, and if it doesn't work for you, it's not that difficult these days to basically fix it and make it work for you. So please enable it and use it. There were already a couple of Link Heartbleed and a couple of those other ones. If you had SE Linux running, the impact would just been much smaller for you. So, and on networking, we started using Open vSwitch as a switching layer, not a standard bridging. Now we're using CentOS as an operating system, just plain CentOS KVM setup. But we added the Open vSwitch. Initially, we had to do it ourselves. Now in 6.6 or 6.5, Open vSwitch is already standard present in RHEL CentOS 6.5. And why? Basically, in the future, we currently are using the plain old VLAN DMZ production database separation with firewalls and all things like that. But it's also not really a solution that is scalable and flexible. So we are really thinking of going to completely OpenFlow in the future. And basically, OpenFlow allows you to define flows within your network, and their network equipment that is connected to the central OpenFlow controller will basically just make sure that happens and nothing else. So you just say like this server can talk to that server over that port, and you do that for your complete environment. Those rules are basically pushed out through all your network devices, and that's it. Everything else happens magically. So that's software-defined networking, really, and it's I see a lot of future in that, and that's where we want to go. Basically, it's you don't have a separate firewall which you need to manage. It's you don't have a set of VLANs which you need to remember, you need to trunk and all that stuff disappears. So that's also something we're going to do really soon in the future. Okay, then finally, why we chose Open Nebula? Well, it's open source, so that was already a big plus. I think the most important reasons on this list for us, basically, it's really enterprise-minded. You can see it on the environment, the community around it, you guys, basically. You can see it on their release cycle, how they do it. And also, it does not enforce a certain platform. Like, if you go the OpenStack way, it's basically, this is OpenStack, this is how you use it. Take it or leave it, and that's your choice. And that doesn't really work for us. It's I want to be able to play with it, adapt it to our needs. It has CentOS packaging. It's a nice plus. It works with stock CentOS core hosts. You don't need to do anything specific or install specific stuff or add a whole set of daemons or make it all complicated now. It's flexible, extensible. You can dig in, play with it, making it easy to hack and to debug. Also, very important for us was the interface to public clouds. For the moment, we're basically just a private cloud. We do everything in-house. But we can see basically our managers really into that is be able to use public cloud resources for certain aspects of what we do. There are some security and network implications, so we're still investigating technically how exactly we're going to do that, but just being able to say, okay, our tool supports that, no issue, really, it's really a plus. The OneFlow state automation engine basically allows you to define an application and work with that. We're also is something really we really like. We're not using it right now, but we're going to plan to use it. We're just still working on basically the Puppet side of things, basically script everything as much as possible. And then the next step will be basically allowed to use OneFlow, basically dynamically grow our environment as we need it. It has a fancy GUI. That's not really for me, but customers or some people of our team really like fancy GUIs. So okay, we have one, no problem. Again, open vSwitch support, like we want to go the open flow way in the future. So, and basically the storage layer is, it doesn't care what storage you put beneath it. So that was also really handy. Like, okay, we can separate those choices. It's not like if we choose it, we have to do that on the storage side of things. As the end result, this is what we have today. It's really small, I know, but it's just an indication. Like, okay, we've been going a long way since the like 6-7 physical machines. We have different network zones, a lot of different VMs. We made everything redundant, so everything is basically doubled. We've gone a lot further with security. We defined all the flows and then interact everything, connect everything. Yeah, it's actually been a fun journey getting to this. And actually, Open Nebula, actually the best thing about it is it has been there for us transparently. We didn't have any specific issues with it. It just was there, it worked, and then so we spent not much time within that compared to all the other things we were doing, but I think that basically just speaks for it. It's a positive thing, not a negative thing. Okay, so where are we going then in the future? Well, there are some forces driving change. That change is constant, change is everywhere, but these are the things we are encountering now. So, that hardware that you saw, large pieces of it is becoming end of life. So, we have a choice. Do we just replace it with something new, more fancy, whatever, or do we completely move into a sort of cloud environment and go there? That's one of the questions we are asking ourselves and discussing within us internally. Then within Deloitte, there are some internal opportunities. There's a new group that I started, which is called the Analytics Lab. basically a small group of people specialized really on working with data, and they do one-shot projects at a customer. Like basically from the idea, like on the CEO level, CXO level, what questions, problems, issues do you have today? And looking at your data, how maybe we can find an answer in there for your those questions. So there are relatively shorter projects, 2-3 months, with a fixed set of data, and they just go in there, analyze, and get value out of that data. But those people need then some place to process all the data, work with that data. So they're used to be doing it on their own laptops, but that not really, they have their limits. Especially when we start working with bigger amounts of data. So they needed something bigger to play with. So they think, okay, do we buy a server? Or, well, they can also come to us and we can host that for you. And whenever you have your project, we make you a big VM, you can play. Well, at the end of the project, we throw it away and that's it. They also built an innovation client center in our main office. It's called the Green Zone, and green is one of the Deloitte colors, so never mind. But it's basically a bit of a follow-up on the analytics lab, like customers come there and then basically we help them visualize their data, play with their data, get insight from their data. But of course, that front end also needs a back end, and that again could be us. And we just see throughout Deloitte more focus on analytics. So we see just people from outside our division or even from outside consulting asking about, we want to do some analytics, can you help us guys? And then we also see that we see the need growing for multiple instances of our platform. So I said we also do management of BI analytic applications at customers. Now, for the moment, that's basically whatever setup they had there from historically reason or somebody else set up. And then, yeah, when you run a platform like this, you really learn how to install and configure and tune those applications. So we have a lot of know-how, or actually how to run those things the best way. And a lot of problems that customers could be resolved if you basically take what we're doing, run it at their site, and not keep using their old whatever setup they did with historical mistakes and things like that. To reduce latency is basically more on, if you look at big international companies, so we are in Belgium, the data centers, all our data stuff is also here in Europe for the moment. But big international companies, for example, yeah, when you cross the ocean, it reduces latency, and we can see customers wanting to basically have something more close to them to be able to speed up a bit. And then you also want to go cross data center. Now we're basically doing more an active-passive setup, but we also want to move to active-active to have the DR more easily for us resolved. So what we have today is okay, but we still need to go forward a bit. So for version 3 then of our platform, we want to go even further with automation. So more Puppet scripts basically. On top of that, we want to do orchestration. That's basically where the OneFlow engine comes to it. Like, it will measure performance of the applications, and when more performance is needed, it will add extra machines. And then with the automation, with Puppet, everything gets scripted, installed, automatically run, and we don't even need to get out of bed for that. So that would be very good. And it allows us to scale out. The black box basically refers to be able to have our platform, basically take that and install it, a copy of it in a customer site or at on a data center across the ocean in the US somewhere for to scale out. And then we want to host the other environments, like sandboxes, demos, proof of concepts. We also get a lot of requests for that usually. And like I said, other teams, not specialized in analytics, but getting more interest and then want to go in that direction. So that's basically where we need to go in for the future. So things we learned playing with OpenNebula. Build dev and production environments for everything, including OpenNebula. And basically that allows you to play, to upgrade, to test new releases, before you put them in production. Testing new releases is also important. There are changes in behavior between releases. And there are also new features that come out that may be interesting, but you first want to be able to play with it to basically know how does it behave, how what does it do exactly, before you can just try to use it in production. So read the release notes. They're very actually interesting, very interesting to read. Do not directly build your production setup, basically meaning like, okay, we install OpenNebula, and then automatically after 2 months, that basically became our production OpenNebula. It's like, okay, that's not the way to do it. You play with it, and then you throw it away, and then you start from scratch, and that will become your production. And a very stupid reminder, you use CentOS and KVM, you need to install the ACPI daemon and make sure it runs, typically stop and start your VMs from inside, from outside, from OpenNebula. It's stupid, but if you don't think about it, like, why doesn't it work? Okay. It was that, very simple. Some things we still feel are missing, or maybe issues that we hope will be resolved in the future. Now, partly guilty of this, I've not reported this in any form or way, so I will correct that in the future. But I can already start talking about it. Online scaling of compute resources, at least with KVM. KVM can do that with CentOS 6 and 7. You can add memory, add CPUs on the fly if you want. But for the moment, OpenNebula does not allow you to do that. Now, you could do it on the command line, except for one problem. When OpenNebula deploys a VM using libfirst and everything, to be able to, on the command line, add memory and CPUs, need to set the max memory and the max CPU to a certain level. And by default, this is not set with OpenNebula. Basically, it means it will be set to how you start your VM initially. So you can't grow. You can reduce, but you can't grow. So step one would basically allowing us to set that max value a bit higher than normal. So when you're already on the command line directly on the host, scale the VM. Step two will basically, if you can do that in OpenNebula, just by clicking. Something we also very much like is Postgres support for the backend of OpenNebula. Nothing against MySQL, but as I said, our experiences with Postgres, it's much more enterprise, and we prefer that. Well, you have the replication set up, you know how that works, and then we would very much like to use Postgres as our backend for basically everything. Also very something stupid, the last two, well, stupid. For the moment, as OpenNebula out of the box does not really support the concept of having virtual IPs or service IPs on VMs. By default, there is the MAC address spoofing and things like that, which is enabled when you use open vSwitch and OpenFlow. Basically mean if you enable or add a service IP to a virtual machine, that will not work over the network. It will be blocked by the rules in OpenVSwitch, which are set up by OpenNebula. So the workaround now is really simple, but just in the source disable the parts where you basically set those rules and then it all works. I understand why the rules are there, so it's not against that. But somehow the concept of having multiple IPs on a VM, as a service virtual IPs basically, you have an IP that points to the VM itself, but you have extra IP addresses who point to the services running on that VM, like a web server, like a DNS server, like the database. So we have 3, 4, 5, sometimes 10 IPs running on one VM. So if you could add the concept of the difference between those two types of IPs in OpenNebula, like, okay, this is a VM IP address, it's part of the machine, it will never go away. And then have a set of virtual IPs, which potentially can move between VMs if there's a failover scenario, things like that. But still allow those, so they're known to OpenNebula, and it will allow those in the rules it has. That was something we also would really like to see. All right, that's basically the end of the things I had. If there are any questions, I think I'm really okay on timing. So, yes? Well, basically, to for example,
can you please repeat the question?
So the question is like, why we want to use those different IP addresses for services? Very simple example that really requires it is if you have a failover setup, like you have an active application on one VM and is standby on the second one. You won't be able to reach that for the client. You won't always want to reach that application over the same IP address. So if you do a failover from one VM to the other, that IP that's related to the service needs to move over to the other side. So that basically forces you to be able to use that concept. And we gone further, like we also for management aspects, for SSH keys and security, we allow, for example, SSH over the VM IP, but not over the service IPs. And then the service IPs are only allowed, the applications are only allowed access over the service IPs. So you basically split the management and the actual functional application side. And for that, you need multiple IP addresses to be able to do that. And also, DNS-wise, you have the machine names, which points to the VM IP. We also have then the service IPs. You can give them simple names. You have proxy, you have web server, and their DNS, and they point to the service IP, and they just flow within your environment.
Wait.
Thanks. Well, you told us Deloitte is an international company. Departments using your same setup?
Not for the moment, but there is interest from the UK, if I recall correctly, and from Canada, and actually also from Curaçao. They have you're Dutch, so you know the Netherlands Antilles. They're also for getting more into analytics, and they're been coming to us, to our team in Belgium, to help them. So maybe in the future they can also be benefit from having a local version of this platform with them. No. The databases are running on physical machines. So we have a dedicated hardware cluster of two nodes with local storage, with high-speed interconnects to run the database cluster. That's also for flexible for us means like running the workload in the correct environment for that workload. So like a regular web server, DNS server, that's a VM, no question. Database for us, because it's our platform lives with data, so it's really important, performance is really important. And the only way to guarantee that is to have basically dedicated setup for the database. And then we have in between, it's like the ETL. It's a process that takes a lot of power, but it's also time critical. It really runs at night, but needs to finish before a certain deadline. We need to be able to guarantee that it always finishes before that deadline passes. So if you have a really big public cloud where you run that, you can always guarantee, because of whatever other people are doing, you can lose performance. So for example, an ETL could be a VM, but then in a dedicated private cloud where you always know this will be the performance of this machine.
Please repeat the question.
Yeah, so we use GPFS, and the question was, did you consider a Ceph? We looked at it a bit, but again, it's like the production readiness of Ceph and the ecosystem around it was at, yeah, so we were talking about a bit more than 2 years ago when we made a decision. So at that moment, it was like, okay, this is not ready enough for us to be able to use this in production and able to guarantee our platform on that. So we might visit again in the future. We're always looking around and see what's new. That's also why I come to these. Yeah, basically all the different things I already mentioned. The documentation is really good. Whatever new release, the documentation is updated and there are the release notes who are of good quality. There's a nice community. The way you build and package it with the different releases, the release cycles are all basically in line with what we expect. As for enterprise-ready software, it's not like, oh, this is version 1.11 and tomorrow we'll release the 0.11.2 and then you need to upgrade in this script and this, that. No, it's it's clear, it's simple, so that's why.
I have two questions.
Yeah?
One, I don't know if you mentioned it, but I didn't catch it. What OpenAVLA version are you running currently?
For the moment, we're at 4.8. So we try to actually keep up really close to the release cycle and follow that. The question was raised in the previous talk. Like for us, the cycle is okay. The tempo is good enough for us to be able to have time to test and follow and then go along each step. So
perfect. And the second question is, have you applied any modifications to the drivers, like data store drivers, transfer manager drivers,
or
you keeping the code as is mostly?
So the only thing we actually play with is the open vSwitch part, to be able to disable that those rules were blocking our service IPs, but all the rest basically works out of the box. Just some configurations, but nothing actually going into the code itself. It just works for us like that, so there's no need.
More questions, please. Okay. Thank you, Tim.
Thank you all.